ओके, होप आई एम ऑडिबल।
यस मैम,
ओके, सो लेट्स कंटिन्यू। एट द एंड देर इज अ मैसेज, जस्ट रिमाइंड मी अबाउट दिस मैसेज। आई हैव टू शेयर वन मैसेज टू यू गैस। ओके, जस्ट रिमाइंड मी अबाउट दैट। ओके ओके, लेट्स स्टार्ट। सो लास्ट क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द स्पार्स ट्री, दैट टू एस्पेशली विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू एट्रीब्यूट बेस्ड ग्रामर्स। So already in syntax, that is in the second phase, we have already seen how the parse tree would be generated based on the grammar. And here in last class, we have discussed, that is with respect to semantic analysis, we said we can even do the evaluation pattern. The evaluation also can be done. With respect to the values, you can even apply some sort of calculations also can be done. So when we say how it could be written, then we one way of writing it is by using this attribute based grammar. So when you are writing with respect to attribute based grammar, what happens, you will be having the grammar. Along with the grammar, you will be having the action to be applied. So when we say action, for applying the action, we require some variables. So those variables we call it to be as attributes. So first we have identified for each non-terminal, or for required terminals also we can have the attributes. So based on that, we have applied the calculation. So those calculations for each rule will be applied. So if you remember, we have done it for binary example, that is accepting the binary number. And if you see the first rule, that is number gives sign list. For this, the attribute rule, the action what it is going to apply is, you have a variable which has been initialized with the value 0, and then you have a condition if statement, the statement if true is statement as well as the false statement. And similarly for the production rule, sign gives positive, the action applied is the attribute rule which is applied is sign negative, sign dot negative is assigned with false. So like this for all the other rules also, you are having certain action applied. So based on this, we have generated. So we know already, all of us know how to generate the parse tree. So now along with the parse tree, we have to have the attributes also mentioned. So if you say the parse tree along with the attributes, when you mention, we call this to be as the dependence graph. Okay, so a parse tree along with the attributes mentioned. So when we say attributes mentioned, we will also have the flow, how the values are getting passed. So along with parse tree, if you are having the attributes mentioned, then we call this to be as the dependence graph. Okay, so already we have discussed about the attributes and the flow of the values, how it goes. So if you remember, we had some variables, position and the value. So when we have written the attribute rules, we could see some attributes has been assigned with the value, that is left hand side of the production rule contents has been assigned to right hand side attribute. So we can assign the left to right or right to left movement is allowed, especially if you see for this case, that is when we had two same variables, that we had numbered it list 0 and list 1. So if you see in this first production rule as well as in the second third production rule, if you see here, list 0 dot position added with 1, and it has been assigned to your child node. Okay, that is, which is nothing but we call it to be as list 1. Right, now if you see in this case, that is list 1 dot value has been added with bit value, and it has been assigned to your root value. That is, we named it to be as list 0. So I can say that in terms of the production, when compared with the production rule, we can have the attributes, the values for the attributes can be flown from left to right or right to left. So the movement of data can be from left to right or right to left. Okay, when we see it in terms of with respect to the production rule. So keeping that in the parse tree, the values can move from top to bottom or bottom to top. So based on that, we have categorized the attributes. We can call attributes which can fall, we can call it to be as synthesized attribute or inherited attributes. Okay, so based on the flow of the data, for each attribute, we name it to be a synthesized attribute or inherited attribute. So when we say synthesized attribute, what is synthesized attribute? So synthesized attribute means if you are having the attributes and the flow of the data is done from bottom to top, that is leaf node to root node, if the flow of the data is happening, then we call those attributes to be as synthesized attributes. In short, I can even call this to be as S attributes. Or I can even say, if your attributes are of synthesized one, then I can even name it to be as S grammar. Okay. When you're referring your if you're browsing, you can even find somewhere S grammars. Right. So this S grammars are nothing but it means that the attributes associated with the parse tree, the flow of data is happening from leaf node to root node. OK. So synthesized attributes are the one which it means. So if you are having synthesized attributes, we call those grammars to be as S grammars. OK. Similarly, we can even have the other attributes which is named to be as inherited attributes. So inherited attributes, which means as the name specifies, if we are going to inherit the properties. So when we say we are inheriting the properties, we usually inherit the properties from parent node. So the flow of data from in your attribute also will be from root node to child node. So it will be top to bottom. OK, so for the previous example, whatever we have taken. So in the previous example, if you say remember, the position and the value, we have three attributes put together. We have three attributes altogether. We have named it to be as the negative, value and position. So if you see the value and negative, the flow of data is happening from leaf node to root node. So that means these two attributes come under synthesized attribute. OK. Moving on to the other third attribute which we have, which is position. The value, the data for this position attribute is moving from top to bottom. So this attribute is considered to be as inherited attribute. OK. Hope it is clear. So till here we have discussed in last class. OK. So keeping these attributes, we can even name the grammar. So if you find anywhere the grammar to be as S grammar, which means that the attributes associated with the grammar, the flow of data is happening from leaf node to root node. So it means that it has some synthesized attributes. OK, now when we go with this attribute based grammar, we have already seen the data can be flown from left to right or right to left. So keeping that in note, we should know about the evaluation methods. So what are the different evaluation methods existing and which is the one which we have used? So keeping how we have to, that is, we are going to evaluate the parse tree. So when we are evaluating the parse tree, what are the ways how and all we can evaluate the parse tree? Whether we should always go with the keep calling the left side left non-terminals and then move on to the right, or do we have to evaluate as and when the data comes into picture, how it has to be evaluated. So based on all these categories, the evaluation pattern has been categorized to three. So it is named as dynamic method, oblivious method and rule based method. OK. So we'll just discuss overall on this, about this. Why we have to take care about this evaluation method? Because we are having the tree into the picture. So when we are evaluating the tree, we have to know how the in which order you are going to evaluate. OK, so starting with the first method. So when we go with this dynamic method, so here what happens is here it is completely depending on the structure of your parse tree. So when we are depending on the structure of the parse tree, how it has to be, how it will be evaluated is when in your parse tree, you will be having some root node and from root node, you keep moving on to the child node. So when we are moving like this, how the evaluation happens is based on your topological sort. So when we say topological sort, how the sorting method applies. So say for example, if you are having some nodes, something like this. It's not clear. One second, I'll draw it neatly. Say for example, if you have a node, say two nodes, you have, say some three nodes, you have here two nodes and here three nodes. Name it as 1, 2, and give some random numbers. So 1, 2, 5, some 7, 3, some 9, 4, some other number. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, and we have some connections done. Say it is this, this here, it flows through this one, 1, 2, 3. Now it flows to this one. It'll give a connection to this one, to this one, to this one. Let this also flow for all the nodes. Okay, so if we have some structure like this, some parse tree kind of thing like this. So when we say topological sorting, what happens is it will be mention, that is how you are going to evaluate. So usual evaluation happens from top to bottom. The evaluation will go from top to bottom. Along with this top to bottom, at the same level you have multiple nodes. So when we are having multiple nodes coming into picture, so it will be doing left to right evaluation. So visualization will be done from left to right. Okay. So the visualization of your graph will happen left to right and top to bottom. Okay. So if you take up for this, in this case, it will be doing the nodes, how it will be taken care is visualization will happen left to right. So it will see first node, second node, fifth node. Then comes to the next level, no more nodes in that same level. So left to right, we have traversed. The next level which you will be taking up will be 7, 3. So no more nodes left to right when you move. After that, in the next level, when you see, it is 9, 4, and 6. Okay, this is how, this is what we usually call this to be as topological sort. So when we say topological sort, which is nothing but you are having some, that is with respect to your tree, you are going to apply the evaluation. So in the evaluation, how it will be done is, it will be done based on left to right and top to bottom. Okay, so that same way your parse tree also would be applied. The evaluation will be done onto your parse tree also. So it will keep moving from left to right, and when and at what point of time the value attribute values will you will achieve, at that point of time it will start evaluating. Okay, so that means the evaluation happens that is for each rule. Each rule will be applied once you achieve all your values. Okay, so that is how this dynamic method will be working. Moving on to the next method, which we call it to be as oblivious method. Here what happens is, here it is completely independent of your parse tree. So here Here it is just based on the attributes. In your attribute, at what point of time, where it keeps moving from repeatedly, it keeps passing the contents from left to right, or it will keep passing from right to left. So whichever pass you want, it can take out, but it will be done repeatedly. And in each pass, when you finish, when you make sure that in each pass, at what point of time the attribute is getting the value, only at that point of time the evaluation will happen. That means once your attribute gets value to execute your particular expression, once your attributes or all the attributes are having the value, then it will evaluate. That is how it does. So that means it is not depending on the tree itself. It is completely depending on your attributes. That's the one which is first point itself. So in your oblivious method, it is completely independent of your parse tree. It is only depending on your attributes, and how it will be evaluation will be done is it keeps repeatedly, either it will keep moving from left to right. Repeatedly it keeps moving, and at what point of time your attributes are getting value, it just evaluates at that point of time. Or it will keep moving from right to left based on which pass you are going to take out. What is the advantage of going this method is when you are, it is much easier when compared with the previous one. Why? Because in your previous method, we have to depend on your parse tree also. So when we have to depend on the parse tree, we should have the storages more, and we have to have the computation done on parse tree as well as the action also. Here, we don't have to depend on the parse tree. So computation wise, it is little easier. That's what the overhead is, runtime overhead is little less when compared with your dynamic method. But it has its own disadvantage also, because we should keep moving. We don't know at what point of time the values will be changing, and when you will be receiving. All these things are not proper. Okay, moving on to the last one, which we call it to be as rule-based method. So this is the one which we have used when we were explaining about this binary number example also. Here we have, for each production rules, we have some static rules mentioned. So based on these rules, whatever, that is based on the actions, whatever you have to apply for each rule, based on that, it keeps evaluating. So we know in which order it has to be applied. Okay, so when you are moving here, but in this rule-based method, it is dependent on your parse tree. Okay, so here you are depending on the parse tree, and along with the parse tree, for each node at each level, you have some actions applied. So static, we know offline what step you will be getting the value. So whether the flow of the attributes will be done in the top to bottom or bottom to top. So all these things you will be knowing statically. That is offline itself, you will be knowing it. So usually whenever we go with any tools, usually we go with this rule-based method when compared with other two methods. Okay. So the same example has been taken just for making you understand. We were just discussing about this evaluation methods. That means why we have taken up this evaluation method is because we have to, when we say evaluation, we have to compute something. So when we have to compute something and it is dependent on the tree, that means tree means which is nothing but it has, we can consider it to be as nodes, it to be as nodes and leaves. So when we have to evaluate a tree, there are different methods. So some that is dynamic method, it depends on the tree. So it used some sorting approach. So topological sorting approach has been used over here. So where it will be applying, the evaluation will be done based on left to right, it keeps moving, and top to bottom it will go. So as and when the values are getting applied, then it will be firing the action. Whereas in oblivious method, it doesn't depend on the structure of the graph. That is in your, it doesn't depend on the parse tree. It depends only on your action. So only on your action when you are doing, that is keeps moving, it keeps applying the action, and at what point of time the values you are achieving, only then the execution will be happening. So simply it has to keep iterating again and again. So there's this only advantage of going with this oblivious method is just overhead could be less. You don't have to travel, you don't have to do any computation with respect to the tree. But the apt one which you can use is the rule-based one. So in this rule-based one, which is nothing but for each grammar, you are having certain action applied. So you know at what point of time, how it has to be applied. So all these things are known. But whenever you are going with this evaluation methods, that is especially with any of these three methods, you have to make sure that your dependence graph will not end up in a cyclic form. That is your attribute. So if you see in this given graph, whatever the graph has been shown, all the lines are going in a straight pattern, right? That is either in the leaf node to root node or root node to leaf node. There is no cycle getting formed. So this is the must which you have to check. So if you end up in a cycle, what happens? All of us know, right? If you by mistake, if you end up in a cycle, that is your root node, this root node is depending on the child node, but this child node content has been depending on the root node's content. So something like this, if you form one cycle, if there is any cycle with respect to any attributes, I'll just give one example. So then it will be like you will always be in that particular cycle itself. You will never come out of that cycle. So once you, so that means you will end up in an infinite loop kind of thing. So that has to be avoided over here also. So those type of problems, we call it to be a circularity. So here, whenever you are applying the attribute based grammar, you have to make sure that your attributes, by using these attributes, you will never end up in a cyclic form. So if you end up in a cyclic form, it means that you are just taking out your energy. That is, you are just wasting your computation time as well as space. Everything is getting wasted. You will never come out of it. So for that purpose, what you have to do is always you have to make sure that your dependency graph will not end up in a cyclic form. So just to make you understand about the circularity, how you may end up. For that, the same example has been taken, but in this case, here we have taken with respect to three variables, A, B, and C. Okay, so grammar remains same. Okay, the grammar, whatever has been listed, that remains same. But in the attribute-based grammar, we just made use of, just to make you understand about the circularity part, we had taken three attributes, which has been named as A, B, and C. Okay, so let's see what are the actions which we have applied for each rule. So that means rule-based evaluation method is what we have applied. So here first, in the first production rule, we have applied the action applied as list.a has been initialized to zero. Okay, so we have an attribute named a, which has been initialized to zero. Similarly, in the second production rule, which is list gives list bit. So when we see the production rule, we have the same name getting repeated. List and list here. Here also list, here also list. So what we have to do is we have to just suffix it with some number. So we have just subscripted it with some number. So initially we have starts with zero. So we have given the left hand side of your production rule to be zero, the right hand side with the value one. Okay. So any more if you are having, we can give two as it goes on. Okay. So that when you are in the attribute part, when you are calling the list, you can specify whether you are calling the first one or the one which is the other side of your production rule, left hand side of the production rule, which one you are specifying, that can be mentioned. So for understanding that, it has to be numbered. So now if you see the actions, what attribute rules, what has been applied. So list 1.a will be nothing but list 0.a plus 1. Okay, so that means list 0.a means, which is nothing but root node content. So root node content plus 1. What about b variable? List 0.b will be list 1.b content. Okay, list 0, the root node will be having the leaf node contains b variable. Coming to c variable, list 1.c will be getting the value with respect to list 1.b plus bit value. Okay. So this is the production rule which has been, this is the attribute rule which has been applied onto this particular production. Moving to the next production, which is list gives bit. Okay, coming to this production, list gives bit. So over here, what is the action applied? Action applied is list, here there is no confusion, we have only one single list, but since it is numbered as 0, so here also this number has been used. So list 0.b will be nothing but list 0.a plus list 0.c plus bit. Same level, a, c and the next level's bit value. Okay, moving on to the next production rule, bit gives 0, bit value is 0 itself. Those two remain same. The last two production rules action remain same, 2 to the power of bit position. Okay. So now let us just trace the using this parse tree, same binary number -101 for the same example. So for the example -101, the parse tree will look something like this as shown over here, right? So for each node we are having the attributes A, B, C. For bit we are having the attribute value. So all the things as mentioned here. Okay, so when it starts, we have initialized A with 0. So that is the reason why A has been initialized to 0. Now list has been expanded to list and bit, right? So when you are expanding the list with list bit, what happens? We are going to apply this particular attribute rule. So in this particular attribute rule, what you are having? List 1.a will be nothing but list 0.a plus 1. So that means this A will be getting the value with respect to this A. So 0 plus 1, 1. Right? So the flow will be in this direction. Now, what about B? B will be nothing but list B value will be opposite direction. It will be applied. That is list 0, this root node's B value will be nothing but child node's B value. So this is how the flow for B variable will go on. Moving on to C variable. So C variable, if you see, so C variable is depending on its own levels B value plus C value. Okay. So this is how it will be mentioned. Till here it is fine. No issues. Now, when we reach to the next production rule, that is list gives bit. So when we reach over to that, what happens? List gives bit. So here when you see, it says list B will be nothing but list 0A plus list 0C bit dot value. Okay. So that means when you are having this particular level, 1 second students. Sorry for that. Okay, so when you reach to the next production rule, we can see list the same level, if list 0.b is depending on the value of list A and list C. Okay, so you just draw the arrow and you can also analyze it. So this one, B is depending on A's value and the same C value also, right? So now if you see, we have an arrow something like this also. You can see B is depending on this part also, right? So here itself, there is a cycle getting formed. So C is depending on B, and B is depending on C. So here there is a cycle getting formed. So this sort of cycle should never be formed. So this is what you have to take care of. Is it clear? That's the reason why we have shown it not with respect to values. We have just shown it with respect to graphs. So if you can see here, this part B is depending on the A's value. That is, B is equals to A plus C at the same level, plus bit value also. Bit value, it doesn't matter. It is separately, it is getting achieved. But if you see with respect to B and C, C is depending on this B value, right? Here also C is depending on C value. Here there is no issue because here list has been further expanded to list and bit. But here list has been expanded with bit itself. This is the production rule which we have applied. So when we are applying this production rule, this is the action which we are going to apply. So when we are applying this action, we are depending on the same level attribute contents. So when you are applying, when the same level attribute contents, you are depending. And here there is a cycle getting formed. C is depending on B value, B is depending on C value. So like this, a cycle should never be formed. So this is what we call it to be a circularity. Okay, so always you have to make sure that your attribute grammar doesn't have this circularity. So when you draw your dependency graph also, you have to make sure that the attributes will not form in a cyclic form. Cycle doesn't get formed. Okay. So hope it is clear how the cycle has been formed. When do we call it to be a circularity? In the previous example, we don't have the circularity. Okay. So just another view about the circularity. Is it clear, students? It's a bit theory, but there is some problems also here. Okay, here it's just shown with respect to both the attributes here, both the production rules. Okay, so we have to avoid this. So how we can avoid how can we handle that? How can we avoid having this circularity? So there are two ways how we can avoid. One is whenever you can restrict your grammars, that is when you are forming your attributes, you can restrict yourself saying that you will be having only synthesized attributes, no inherited attributes, or either ways. So if you are since you are having the attributes, that is the attributes flow of data is happening from top to bottom as well as bottom to top, both the ways it is happening. That is the reason you may end up having this circularity, right? So instead of that, what you can do is whenever the attributes you are selecting, you can choose in such a way that the flow will happen only in one direction. So that is one way of taking care of. That is one way you can avoid your avoid circularity. Okay. So the other one is by using the evaluation cycles. Okay, here also it is based on the iterations. So how many iterations it takes and all those things will be compared, and you can just avoid it. Fine. One more example. I'm not explaining here. I've just put it over here just for your reference. You can just go through it. Here it is just a simple execution time, how the execution time will be calculated. So here with respect to your arithmetic operations, so the grammar has been already, all of you know about this particular grammar for arithmetic operations, that is plus minus multiplication division and this part till here, till this part you all are familiar with. Where either it could be number or it could be identifiers, and with the parenthesis. The above part which you have here is, it's just for assignment, that is the expression part, that is A is equals to B plus C, just for having the assignment statement as well as for blocking part. Okay. So the grammar has been given for the entire block of structure. So here it is the attributes, what you have used chosen here is only cost. So here the cost over here means it is the execution time, that is what it has been expected. So you can just go through it. I'm not going to explain over here. So any doubts you can just get back. Okay. So moving on to the continuation of this attribute based grammar. So right now, what are the things which we have discussed in attribute based grammar? So we just saw about how this attribute based grammar will be, what exactly it means, how do you form the rules. So when you form the rules, what are the attributes which you are having? So synthesized attributes and inherited attributes. So when you are using these two attributes, you may end up having the circularity. So that has to be avoided. And how the evaluation, so how you are going to compute it. So computation, we have seen three methods, and the one which we have explained is based on rule-based approach. Okay. So now, what are the problems what we come across with respect to attribute-based grammar? Okay. So by this time, all of you might have understood. If you have understood this attribute-based grammar, you might have understood. So the first thing is, for each production rule, we are having more than one attribute. So when we say more than one attribute, each attribute needs to be maintained. Okay, and some attributes can flow from top to bottom. Some attributes will flow, the data flow will happen bottom to top, right? So the copy, sometimes the copy of each, for each node, the copy of the previous node has to be maintained. So something like that is what is happening, right? So that means we have certain problems by using these attributes. Okay. So what are the problems based on these attributes has been classified into four categories. Okay. So first one is based on this handling non-local information. So what is this non-local information? So as I have said, we, for each production rule, we have either one or more attributes, and the flow of the attributes will happen from top to bottom or bottom to top. When we are having the flow in this manner, what happens? You should maintain a copy of each value. So sometimes the leaf node, the child node may be depending on the root node's content. So and later only the root node's content might be changing. So for all these purpose, you have to maintain the copy of it. Okay, copy of the previous one. So when like this, when you are maintaining the copy of each variable, what happens? The storage also will increase. So you have to maintain the storage. There is a limited storage. So you have to compromise with respect to the storage also. So storage also has to be taken care. So for copying the same content, same variable content for each node, that also has to be taken care. So storage will be increasing. So when you are saying only the storage is the with respect to copying the contents, is that the one? No, because when you are going with these attribute based grammar, this evaluation is happening based on the parse tree. So when you are saying parse tree, the parse tree is drawn with respect to the production rule only once. So you have production, that is the parse tree, it will be drawn with respect to the all of you, right now all of you know how the parse trees are getting drawn, right? So each non-terminal would be mentioned, and that particular non-terminal would be expanded. So it goes on like that till you reach to the required strings. So when you see the parse trees, the length of your parse tree or the content of your parse tree is much huge. So you have to save, store that parse tree. The information of your parse tree is also required. So there also you require some storage. And each time you are calling your, invoking your production rules, each time the parse tree also will be invoked. Okay. So when you say each time the parse tree is getting invoked, the entire tree has to be, that much space is also required. Okay. So there is one solution for this. Instead of going for parse tree, there is another tree called abstract syntax tree, which we will be discussing in the next chapter. But I'll just give you a gist of what is abstract syntax tree. Say for example, if you are given this expression, 3 into 4 into 4 plus 5. So all of us know how the parse tree for this will look like. Can you just draw the parse tree for this with respect to the production rule, which you know, that is expression equals expression plus term, or expression minus term, or term. Term would be nothing but term multiplied by factor, or term divided by factor or factor, and factor would be number or ID. So keeping that, if you draw your parse tree, it would be expression, from expression, it would be plus operator would come. So expression plus term, and this expression would be further mentioned to be as term, and this term would be expanded to multiplication, that is term multiplied by factor, and this term would be mentioned to be as factor, and this factor would be represented for 3. So 3 multiplied by this factor would be mentioned for 4, which is a number, plus this term would be applied for factor, and this factor would be 5. This is how your parse tree will look like. So instead of this, we can even go with abstract syntax tree. For in abstract syntax tree, it doesn't apply the that is, we don't apply the production rule. We directly apply the tree would be generated based on your expressions. So it would be something like the operator plus, which is 5, the next operator which you have, which is multiplication, which is applied onto 3 and 4. So this is one solution for using, instead of using the parse tree. So if you just compare these two cases, both are evaluating the expression 3 multiplied by 4 plus 5. But when you compare it with respect to the space, the tree format itself, the space requirement is very much less when for abstract syntax tree when compared with your parse tree, right? Because in parse tree, you should have the information regarding your grammar also. Here, we are directly applying the whatever rules we are having, that is directly applied onto your expression. And the tree would be generated only for your expression itself. So this is the main difference for your parse tree with syntax tree. So this, so one solution with respect to your, for instantiating the parse tree, we can directly go for this abstract syntax tree. But still, each time you are applying the rule for attributes, each time you have to invoke. So that still remains it. Okay. So this is one of the disadvantage of using your attribute-based grammar. And the other disadvantage of going using this attribute-based grammar is locating. So locating the contents. So each attribute value, locating the value for each attribute. So as we have discussed, some attribute values you achieve it from top to bottom. Some attribute values you achieve it from bottom to top. And at what point of time you can achieve that value also depends. So in each pass, you have to just maintain it. Okay. So when we say maintain, maintain means, which is nothing but you have to have the copy of each content. As and when you get the value for that particular variable, that has to be copied and stored for the required nodes. So again, the storage comes into picture. So this is how this is the main problem with respect to your attribute based grammar. So there is one solution which they have suggested. So instead of copying the contents, as and when you get the attribute values, instead of storing it for each and every node, what they suggested is they can have, you can have a repository, and you can store the contents of the attributes in that particular repository. That is like a record. You can maintain a record where the each attribute values, you can store it. As and when you require, you can just take it. Instead of putting it for each and every node, instead of storing the attributes for each and every node, you can store it in a repository, and when required, you can just use it. Okay. But here also there is a problem. So when because in your attribute based grammar, when we say some grammars, some attributes flow, that is some attributes are inherited attributes, some attributes are synthesized attributes. So because of that, the who is going to maintain, that is who is going to update, who is going to access. So concurrency also comes into picture. So when we say concurrency comes into picture, so that also has to be taken care. Who has already accessed and who is going to update. So all those things also has to be taken care. So keeping all these things, so there are many, even though you can, we can apply this attribute based grammar for evaluation purpose, but there are many disadvantages when we go with this attribute based grammar. So we suggest for going for the other method, which we call it to be as ad hoc syntax directed translation. So which we will start it in the next class. Okay. So right now I just winded up with this attribute based grammar. So just discussed about attribute based grammar, evaluation method, and what are the problems when you go use this attribute based grammar. So done for today's class, and I have one message for you guys. So the message is, how many of you are there? Okay, 104 people. So the message here is, so you will not have a class on Monday and Tuesday. Are you listening?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Huh? Only my class. That is only CD class.